If I make money, it's because of decisions I made. If I make a sale, it's because of my choices. If I go work and show houses on a Saturday morning, it's because of my choices. If I work on a Sunday at an open house, it's my choice. And so it's never work. Everything I do, my success or failure, is based 1,000% on the decisions I've made that day. You know, you want to be successful, you want better choices, emulate those who are doing that. Put your work boots on and go to work. Everything else will take care of itself. I really believe that. If you get up every day and try, just do the best you can and not trying to figure out how you can go play and party. If you figure out how you can be productive that day versus how I can be entertained, this comes with stress and cost. But if you get up every morning and try to be productive, whether it means go to work, whether it means go work in your garage, whether it means I need to go work on my Bronco for 4 hours for stress, whatever it takes, you will sleep like a baby. I can't emphasize that enough. You can worry about stuff and stress on stuff and then go, blah, 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 blah. Let me go get a six pack. It just doesn't work, man. It just doesn't.
Ready?
Ready to rock and roll?
Is that action?
All right.
Okay.
That's right.
All right.
Absolutely. Go. 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 Go.
Hello, everybody. It's Jason Will with
Go. Go. Go.
This is a real estate podcast. But. We talk about leadership, personal growth, and becoming the best version of yourself. Leadership, check one, two, check one, two. Growth, best version of yourself.
Go.
So this is a real estate podcast. Andrew Carver, welcome to the Impact Agent Podcast. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you doing?
I appreciate you doing this with us on a Saturday morning. We're sitting in your living room of your remodeled home in Robertsdale, Alabama. And for our listeners, Andrew joined Jay Park Houston County early 2020.
January 2020.
Yeah. So we're going to talk a little bit about real estate, but as we were talking off mic, this podcast has really evolved into a personal development leadership podcast. So you have a pretty impressive story to tell in terms of sobriety. And I know that touches a lot of people, a lot of families. And how many years sober are you now?
This is my 11th year.
Okay. And you're a 10 plus year veteran?
Of real estate?
Of real estate?
Yes. I got sober and started real estate about the same time.
Yeah. And we're going to talk about that too, about how the sobriety has led to a number of different hobbies and interests. And some of those are, you know, just recreational. And some of those have been very profit bearing. So, you know, not only as I'm sure the sobriety been for you, good for you personally, it's been really good for you, you know, business-wise and financially. So
it has.
Yeah. So tell us the story a little bit about how long you struggled with alcohol. What do you think was the catalyst for that? And unpack that a little bit for us.
Well, it's real interesting, and I certainly am very happy to speak candidly about sobriety. But I have to take this step back, and you have to have a little bit of understanding of my history. I was born and raised in Magnolia Springs when I went to Foley, and I wasn't a partier then, and I wasn't a drinker. I really didn't drink until I got 21, and I came from a very stable home, a good life. There was no underlying issues, but when I turned 21, I started drinking, you know, beer, and I liked to drink, and that's just the crux of it. It wasn't that I was trying to hide anything or numb pain. Realistically, I just like the way alcohol made me feel. And so I drank and party at Auburn as I ended up finishing up there in 94. But from 21 on, alcohol, specifically drinking beer, just became a part of my life, you know. And I drank like a college kid did in college, which was, you know, beer all the time, you know, and just everything was a party. And I never really stopped that. Continue to drink like that for a long, long, long time.
So when did you notice that it started to turn into a problem? It was not just a social thing. Did it start causing some disruption and dysfunction in your life?
Well, here's the interesting thing about alcohol is that let me explain how I drank. I drank beer, and I drank a lot of beer, and I drank frequently. You know, a very reasonable, realistic day for me would be go work at a job, you know, where I had a professional career, I had money, I had success, but knock off work, grab a 12 pack on the way home and drink beer that evening. You know, before you knew it, the 12 pack was gone. And that just was start drinking at 6, finish by 10, in bed by 10:15. You know, up at 6:30 the next day, 6:15 to go to work for my Monday through Friday 8-to-5 job, so to speak. But and then on weekends, it was every weekend was a party. So the interesting thing is, an alcoholic will tell you that it doesn't impact their lives. And my excuse for many years was, I got a good job. You know, I don't miss work. You know, I don't go home and beat my, you know, wife or go get in fights or go smash into trees. I'm a good, productive person. So I don't have a problem. And that is a terrible, 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 terrible lie that alcoholics tell themselves. You don't realize it until you look back in retrospect. So your question is, when did alcohol become to a point where it was affecting me? Candidly, it affected me from day one. You drink to intoxication, you are making poor choices, period. Whether you're out with your friends on a boat all weekend or you're watching the ball game, to this day, I see people posting on Facebook in the evening, and I go, I bet you that post is going to be gone tomorrow because they're drunk and they're making a poor choice. And that's something that we all see on social media. And it's just, I'm glad it wasn't around when I was a drinker.
Yeah.
But I just want to really emphasize that an alcoholic will tell you, if I would have never drank from day one, I have no idea how much more money I would have, how much more things I have. Don't get me wrong. I have an amazing life today. And I'm here today because of choices I've made in the past, good and bad. But I do know it was a lot of money. There was a lot of cost emotionally. You don't develop. If you start drinking it like early, you don't emotionally develop. Your mind and your emotion and your maturity level remains. You literally don't get past that 19-year-old frat boy. You don't in your mind. But all that being said, in 2009 is when my life really, really, really got bad. And it was a combination of, well, let me just say one thing. Every decision, every bad thing that happened to me was because of my choices. Every single thing that happened to me was because of my choices. Now, I was in a career that I wasn't happy with a work commute that I wasn't happy with, and professionally I wasn't happy. I was in a marriage that I wasn't happy. I was in making poor choices with the alcohol. It was never drugs, and it was never hard liquor. It was always beer, but I could drink as many beers as you could put in front of me. But all of that kind of came to a head in 2009, and it just, you know, for the longest time I was a drunk, but I was a happy drunk. I was the life of the party. I was, you know, hey, it was all about having fun. I wasn't the aggressive drunk. I didn't get in fights and all that nonsense. Just wanted everybody to have a good time. Drink with me. Let's all have fun. But in 2009, it just compiled and compiled and compiled and compiled until it just, my whole life just blew up. I get a little emotional just thinking about that time, and specifically it was in August of 2009, where several instances, things just piled upon and it kind of blew up. So that's when I realized that I needed to make a change.
Do you feel comfortable talking about specifically what one of those instances might have been that got your attention?
I'm happy to go into detail of exactly what happened and where I was at, because but it's pretty heavy stuff. Yeah. So it was in August of 2009, and I was working, and I was on a company trip in Germany, of all places. And I like to tell the story. So we got into Germany. Here I am, an American Miller Lite drinker.
Yeah.
Bud Light. And I get into this German beer, and it was delicious. And it had, like, rainbows and unicorns coming out of it. Oh, I drank it. But that stuff packs a punch.
Right. It's more potent.
And so I was already in a really terrible place mentally with my relationship with my then spouse. And I was extremely unhappy at work. And so in August, I was in Germany and I drank too much and I made a fool of myself. That was the first time where drinking had really impacted my professional life. Like, I'd never missed work. I didn't call off hungover. I didn't go to work drunk. But that was, it was, you know, really impactful. And that the next day I had a heart-to-heart meeting with some work colleagues about my behavior in a hotel in Germany. And I was really embarrassed. I went back to my hotel room and at the time contemplated, you know, looking out, I was on the fourth floor and looking at the bed sheets, trying to figure out if I could hang myself.
Really?
Yeah, it was, I was so professionally embarrassed. I literally was so unhappy in my marriage. I was so unhappy with so many things that I just couldn't get out, man. Like I didn't know what to do. I didn't know what to do. And some people know this, but not a lot of people, but I was at the proverbial end of my wits, the end of my rope. I didn't know what to do. And so I got on my knees and I'm not a praying guy. And I tell this story because I laugh about it now when I think about it, but I was in this hotel in Germany and I got on my knees and I just prayed. I just prayed and I said, I don't know what to do, God. I don't know what to do. And I was crying. It's like, I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. And I think it's, the funny thing is, I think if God would have said, Andrew, listen to me, you're going to be sober from now on. You're going to get out of this 15-year career you did in human resource management. You're going to be divorced in a few months. You're going to move to Foley and then Robertsdale. These are things that are in your future. I would have argued with God. Like, I literally would have said, that's not the right answers. But that's what's incredibly important about this, is when you're in a situation that you put yourself in because of your choices, you got to look at other choices after that. Like, because your choices are garbage, okay? The choices I had made had put me in a place where I was terribly bad off. The right answers were over here. And if God would have actually said, here's the list, Andrew, that's what you're going to do, I literally would have argued with him. The guy that had made decisions for years and did things one way would have argued. But that's what happened to me. Like, you know, I like Disney now with my wife. We love to go to Disney World. I'm extraordinarily compassionate about animals. I don't want to go hunt and things. I've got cats here. I changed. But I did so because the choices I were making at the time were terrible. So in that hotel in Germany, that afternoon I made a decision. I said, that's it. I'm changing things. And the very first thing I was going to do was not drinking anymore. But I didn't know how to do that. So I actually checked myself into rehab in Birmingham. God, so long ago. But I said, I'm going. I quit my job. I literally emailed them and said, I'm no good to anybody right now. And I'm quitting, you know, and say, you know, to be candid, at the time I was trying to save face professionally because I had made a goof out of myself. And it put other people, my work colleagues, in a very difficult spot. So I just quit and checked myself into rehab. And when I was there, I just had made up my mind that I was going to be sober. And so everything they were teaching, I was learning. But the more important part of that was I got a chance to just get away from my life and hit the restart button, so to speak, and had 2 weeks of clarity to kind of evaluate things. And shortly thereafter, when I was driving, I need to say this. So I flew back from Germany to here with the intentions of driving up to rehab, which I did. On the way to rehab, I had already quit my job, a 15-year career that I had made a lot of money in. I was successful. I had done some really good things professionally. I had a really good track record, but I didn't know what I was going to do. So I was literally, and I don't even remember the restaurant, but I'd stopped off at a restaurant. It was me and my mother in a buffet line. And I said, I'm going to sell real estate. I have no idea where that thought came from. Nobody had mentored me. Nobody had told me about opportunities. I didn't even know how it worked. When I bought my houses previously, I didn't even look at the paperwork. I just signed. I didn't understand commissions or how it gets. I didn't understand anything, but I had made the decision that I was going to sell real estate.
Wow.
Yeah, I have no idea why to this day. You believe in divine intervention? You tell me.
That's incredible. So the day in the hotel room when you did pray, you found some clarity that day to make the decision.
I am a very intellectual guy. Like, I don't base my things off of feelings or I'm very, very, very black and white, analytical. I'm a right brain thinker. Like, I'm not very fluid. So this speaks to faith. So I have to tell people, like, I don't know what happened. You explain it to me. I don't know to this day. I don't know. So the answer is, did God interject in my life? And the answer, it has to be. It has to be, because there's no rational, intellectual, black and white reason why this stuff occurred. Like, my life changed. I went from, you know, almost throwing myself out of a hotel window to getting on my knees praying and crying for 30, 45 minutes and just not knowing what to do. And then subsequently that day, getting to a very sense of peace and calm and start making the decisions I needed to, which was I needed to resign from the job I had. I needed to find some rehabilitation places to go into rehab, because I knew I couldn't drink and I didn't know how to get sober by myself. And I knew I had to have very frank conversations with my then wife and things, which I did. So yeah, I mean, that's, to this day, that's the only answer. So you have to have faith. You have to believe, you know, I mean, you have to have faith.
Or just in a very simple sense, because some people may be listening to this and go, I've never had faith. I don't even know what it means to have faith. I don't believe in it. It's a bunch of mumbo jumbo. But I think even just having the belief that you can't do it on your own. Like, you couldn't, you're not here today because of Andrew Carver.
No, my decisions were terrible.
Yeah.
My decisions were terrible.
Right.
And if you're a very smart person, which I'm a pretty clever guy, and you have a pretty good job and you pay your bills and your credit score is pretty good, it's tough to tell that guy anything.
Yeah.
It's very, very tough to tell that guy, hey, man, your decisions are crap. And they were. So the Andrew of 2009, despite his accomplishments, accolades, intellect, his decisions were horrible.
Right.
And you had to let somebody else be in control. You had to give up control. You had to say, look, help me. And whether you get that help from, you know, God, a respected mentor, somebody that you know that's doing things that, you know, you want to be successful, you want better choices, emulate those who are doing that and ask them, what do I do? 99% of them will tell you what to do.
Yeah. I went to a leadership training fall of 2019, and I'm happy to talk to our listeners about that experience kind of offline. But one of the big, most impactful, you know, kind of elements of that training that I took away was, you know, your past is perfect. And I put that on Facebook a lot and talk about it a lot. And a lot of people reach out to me privately or even publicly and go, nothing's perfect in this world. Like, nothing's perfect. And so the whole philosophy behind this leadership statement, this leadership training, is that it's perfect for where it delivers you to. And it's perfect for the power of retrospect and perspective on, you know, you can say, I don't ever want to go back to that place. And, you know, it just gives you a great deal of clarity for where you are now. So I think some people maybe listening have feelings of, I've lost so much. I've had so many of those embarrassing moments. It's cost me so many relationships. It's cost me so much money. For that very reason, I don't deserve to be sober, or I don't deserve to live. And you talked about in the onset of this interview about all these things you had to be grateful for now. You know, your marriage, new career, all these hobbies. And so I do want to talk about the post Andrew Carver, post, you know, alcoholism and all these gifts that it has brought you, to give people hope of where they can go. Because you reflect on all you've lost, but I'm sure that just gives you a great deal of energy and validation for where you are now.
Yeah, you know, it does. I want to make a couple of things clear. You know, when I got out of rehab, I went to AA meetings, you know, for the first couple of years after that. And it wasn't, I didn't work steps per se, but if you want to get sober and be sober, you have to be around people that truly are, you know, alcoholics and that are trying to be sober, because they understand that. I just wanted to clarify that.
Yeah.
And because that's, we talk about posts from that August 2009 date. You know, the first couple of years after that, I went, and it was just an amazing thing to just vent to people who truly understood it. You can't talk to your family. You can't talk to your drinking buddies that don't think you have a problem. Mm-hmm. You need to talk to people who at some point in time in their life have said, I don't want to drink anymore. I don't need to drink anymore. This is not smart for me. And that's really cathartic. So, but the post August 2009, Andrew. And it took me a couple of 3 years to realize this. And a very funny example is When in my drinking days, I'd love to go spend the weekend on the river because I could tell people at work, yeah, I'm going to spend the weekend on the boat this weekend. It's a lot of fun. We're going to go boating all weekend. People would go, oh, okay, that's great. What I didn't tell them was I would be going to be drinking 24 beers on Saturday and 24 beers on Sunday. Because that's not cool. You don't tell people, oh, no, I'm going to have two cases of beer over the weekend.
Yeah, that's a lot.
I could do it. I mean, that's not, I don't mean to be silly. That's not exaggeration. I don't drink liquor. I could drink, you know, I could get on the rivers at 9:30 and start drinking a case of beer. And by, you know, we get off the river at 7-8 that night and there ain't no beer left in the cooler. That's not an exaggeration. I could drink as much beer as you put in front of me. I would literally be blackout drunk where I don't remember, wouldn't remember things in the evening, but I would be totally functional. Like I could, it was scary how bad it was. But my point to that was that I thought I liked boat riding. Like I thought I liked the whole boat life. And so when I got sober in 2010, I still had a boat and I would go out on the river, but I wasn't drinking anymore. I thought that's what I was supposed to do because I love to go boat riding. Well, it turned out I didn't really like to be out on the river and go boat riding. I didn't. I don't have a boat now. After a couple of years of attempting to do that activity that I thought I liked to do, I stopped and I just didn't do it. And it literally took me a few years after that to realize it was never about the boating. And that is one other thing that a lot of alcoholics will tell them. They'll like, oh no, I love to go to the hunting club on the weekends with the boys. I love to hunt. I love to hunt. Do you like to hunt or do you like to go there and drink and nobody bother you? And that's your recreation. Because if you're out there and you're hearing me talk about this, if you look at your activities and there's drinking involved, are you doing the activity because you like the activity or because you like drinking and that's your excuse to drink? You know, my excuse to drink, oh, there's a football game Saturday.
Yes.
Let's drink. Oh, we're going boating all weekend. Let's make sure we get our beers. We're going to Biloxi, the casinos, because we want to go play the slots or we want to drink. So, you know, there's several activities that I thought I used to like. I like to do, like one of them was going boating. I don't even want to be on a beach. It's hot out there. I don't drink. And going in, you know, like a crawfish bowl, like, hey, we're doing a crawfish bowl. Like people do crawfish bowls, but a lot of the people go there so they can drink a lot of beer.
Yeah.
It's spicy crawfish. I got to drink these beers. So in going to Biloxi, that doesn't have a big draw for me anymore. But so there's things like that I don't do anymore. And so the question is like, well, what'd you do? Well, I found things now that I didn't think I'd be interested in, but I'm extremely passionate about. One of the first things was renovation of houses. I've actually bought houses that needed a lot of repair, renovated them, and sold them for profit. And I do the work myself. I don't sub it out. Like these floors that we're standing on right here, I put these in.
Wow.
Like, I was on my hands and knees doing this. This house, you know, I've renovated this house completely, but I found that I loved it. I loved doing it. I remember working on the house and replumbing underneath a sink one time. And it's very, you know, the plumbing's not right and this drain. And I was on my back and I was dirty. You know, stuff was getting in my eye. And it was just a house that I was flipping for profit. So I was doing the work myself, replacing these. And it was so frustrating. And I had a moment of clarity. I said, I love this. This is insane that I like doing this. Drunk Andrew prior to 2009 would have never been interested in doing kind of renovations.
I guess it's kind of hard to teach yourself how to do renovations if you're drinking beer all day Saturday, all day Sunday. So you have a great deal of time on your hands to devote to.
Well, it's what your priorities are.
Yeah.
You have to understand, like, my priorities changed. You know, my priorities changed. Where it used to be, my priority is, what can I do and drink beer all day and say I'm, you know, this is what I do. I worked hard all week, so I get to play all weekend. Grown, responsible people, I need to say this carefully, but I feel like I don't have time to go play all day Saturday and Sunday. I don't know how I used to have time. I have things I have to do. So I taught myself all that stuff, everything on rebuilding houses and you know, YouTube. So that's one thing, was actually working on houses and have a very... you know, I feel strongly about how my place looks. I became a realtor, then I started realizing that people take care of their houses.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. It was just, I was like most people out there, you just live in a house. It's just what you do. You just live in it, you know, you just live in it. And then I became a realtor and I realized I probably should take care of this stuff.
Yeah.
And so I do that now. That's one thing.
I'm sure it helps you on the real estate side too, because you know how to, you know what their actual cost is to repair or renovate, or you could probably spot things that are pretty serious repairs and things that just, you know, that buyers may over exaggerate in terms of the severity of it. You can kind of, you know, give them some good solid advice.
Absolutely. And you know, we have to tread very carefully. We're not professional home inspectors, but I can, you know, I mean, I know what I see, I know what I've dealt with, you know, and something that looks very scary on a report, you know, maybe not so scary. And I just know because I've done it myself with these two hands. I didn't sub it out. I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah. So we were just out in your shop before we jumped on the audio here. We saw a big project out in your workshop with a Jeep that you're restoring.
Well, that's the Bronco I'm restoring.
Okay, it's a Bronco.
But I own a 1995 Jeep Wrangler.
That's right.
Which I bought in March of 1995. I graduated from Auburn in December of 94. And as a present to myself, I bought the Jeep that I still have. And it's very nice shape. I have done a lot of work. About 3 years ago, I took all the interior out and put, you know, new carpet and new seats and all that sort of stuff in it and made it real nice. But I've just taken care of it, so it didn't need much restoring. The vehicle that I'm restoring is the 1976 Ford Bronco that I got a couple years ago. And it's just a lot of work. But I love it. It's what I do for fun. It's literally go and I, with these two hands, get under there. I've logged hundreds of hours on that. And just doing it, teaching myself on YouTube videos and rebuilding it.
And had no interest in doing any of this stuff prior to sobriety, no, right? And no. Can never see yourself doing this kind of stuff.
You know, in all fairness, I did some of that as growing up as a little boy. We lived in Magnolia Springs on a 160-acre farm. And, you know, I at times when I was younger, you know, before, you know, 16, I would, you know, help my dad with working on stuff. But it wasn't something that I liked doing. You know, if we had to replace the brakes on the truck, I knew I could do that. But from like 16 to 39 or 40 or whatever, man, I'm not turning a wrench. I mean, I could, and I did some little minor things, but I love that. Like, I love it. As frustrating as it is, I love working on that Bronco. I love it. And that was, I would not have loved it prior to 09.
What about the Spartan races and all this extreme exercise, you know, stuff that you...
I did.
You did.
I did. Well, you know, it's interesting. It's in about 2012, I got real passionate about running obstacle course races. And so I was training 3 and 4 times a week, and I was running these obstacle course races. We ran one in Saraland when the big Spartan race was in Saraland, mm-hmm. 3, 4, 5 years ago. And I ran up to Atlanta and competed in one of those, which was a lot of fun. But I completed the Grand Man Triathlon just on a whim. The one at Fairhope.
Yeah.
And the funny thing is about that, I'd never ridden a bike. Like, I knew how to ride a bike. I didn't ride a bike, but the day before I went and rented a bike.
Wow.
From the bike shop. And I said, well, I'm about to ride this thing for 18 miles. So I just did it, but I was in good shape, you know. So but my whole point that was this, it was exciting and fun. It was another hobby that I'd enjoyed. I got out of it a few years ago. The Bronco. I got into other things, you know.
And the compassion for the animals thing. I mean, you never, did you, were into having pets or?
Well, in all fairness, like I you know, I did have a pet. We had cats. I had a cat when I, in my first marriage, and between 06 and 09. Prior to that, I really didn't have pets. And, but now, like, my heart's huge when it comes to compassion for animals. Like, and that's changed. You know, it used to be I wouldn't say I was not, like, mean, but I was uncaring.
Yeah.
Whereas now, like, there's a little black cat out there that he just showed up in our yard 3 or 4 or 5 weeks ago. And so I feed him every day, and I'm tending to his wounds, and I really want him to be, you know, healthy and try to be better. And we've got 4 cats. I'm real compassionate, you know, coming from, like I'd said, and, you know, I'm a very right thinker, analytical, intellectual, but the compassion for the animals is new.
If you had to point to a few things that maybe you're most grateful for now in life, have you been able to reflect on the way things are and the way things turned out, and do you wake up every day and go, or some days and go, man, this is pretty cool?
I sleep very well at night. And it sounds weird, but I'm very grateful that I sleep well every night. You know, there's no, I wake up feeling weird. I'm very grateful for my wife that I've been married to now for a couple of years. We've been together since 2014. I'm very grateful for the career I have now in real estate. And we haven't really talked about that, but the reality is that whole August 2009 situation prompted me to go into a job where I'm self-employed, and kind of scary, you know. We're 1099. Like, if we don't put deals on the table, we don't eat, you know.
Right.
It's very scary going from a salaried position, making as much money as a 30-year-old can. Life was good money-wise, you know, from that stability, that 401k match, that Cadillac insurance plan, all that that we had, I had as a middle management professional. To go into this thing where, hey, you don't make a sale, you literally will not pay your bills. It's very scary, but I love it because I'm my own boss. I mean, you and Kendall are my boss, but if I make money, it's because of decisions I made. There's no politics. There's no weird rules that don't make sense. If I make a sale, it's because of my choices. If I go work and show houses on a Saturday morning, it's because of my choices. If I work on a Sunday at an open house, it's my choice. And so it's never work. Everything I do, my success or failure, is based 1,000% on the decisions I've made that day. Nobody else. There's no other. There's not any work politics. I elect to do business with who I elect to do business with. And it's my choice. If I have a client, or if there's a person that it's not a good fit for us, I don't have to keep trying to make that work. Now, as a good salesman, it would be in my benefit to try to resolve issues. But if I come to an unreasonable or unsolvable situation, I don't have to stay in that situation. And I can say, you know what, this is just not a good fit. Whether it's with a vendor, a client, whatever. There's no obligation. Whereas if you're a salaried employee and they go, hey, this is your idiot you got to use for this particular thing, and you're just banging your head against the wall because they don't do things like you want to do things or you feel comfortable. And it's a very, so that is one of the biggest pluses, is that freedom to make my own decisions and the flexibility to, you know, make a career jump from HR to Roberts Brothers for 10 years and then to JPAR, you know, which we will have to talk about at some point.
Well, I think that brings up an interesting point about this industry is very stressful. I feel like it's one of the most stressful, you know, when you don't have a guaranteed income, whether you do a good job or a bad job, because it's your salary job. You could have a bad week or a bad day. You know, if you do that in real estate, it could cost you a month's salary. Okay. So as a person who has to get up and, you know, on some level, even if it's subconsciously, manage sobriety. Alcohol is such a, you know, way that people medicate stress. How do you deal with stress these days?
I don't have a lot of stress in my life. And I want to touch on two little issues you talked about. The first one was being the real estate is very challenging. For anybody out there that thinks being a real estate agent is easy, it is extremely hard, because every transaction is different. Every transaction comes up with variables that you never would have anticipated that you have to resolve, which I like. First off, I like resolving problems, but incredibly hard. But I don't get stressed anymore. I just don't, you know, I don't, because I know that if I get up and I do what I'm supposed to do that day, I know I'm making good decisions and, you know, I'm trying to be productive, then I sleep like a baby. I don't, even in the most difficult real estate transactions, there's just no stress in it. I do drink hot tea at night, if that means anything. If you go look in my cabinet, you'll see a ton of variety of different hot teas. So I'll drink a little hot tea at night before we go to bed. But, you know, being sober and being calm and at peace with yourself, and whether it's divine intervention or not, whatever you think you have to wrap your arms around, but just taking a step back and breathing and getting up and trying to do, you know, put your work boots on and go to work, everything else will take care of itself. Truly, I really believe that. If you get up every day and try, just do the best you can.
Yeah.
and not trying to figure out how you can go play and party. You know, it's two different. If you figure out how you can be productive that day versus how I can be entertained, this comes with stress and cost. But if you get up every morning and try to be productive, whether it means go to work, whether it means go work in your garage, whether it means I need to go work on my Bronco for 4 hours for stress, whatever you, I mean, whatever it takes, you'll sleep like a baby. I can't emphasize that enough. You can worry about stuff and stress on stuff and then go, blah, 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 let me go get a six pack. It just doesn't work, man. It just doesn't.
I heard you say a couple interesting things or really make two interesting points. So even no matter what really profession you're in, as long as you're making good choices, those good choices may not have an immediate positive result, but they will compound over time and good things will happen.
Yeah, absolutely.
The other thing I heard you just mention was if you're seeking to be entertained, like if you're looking for life to have this high entertainment value, it's going to result in stress. And I just go, that goes towards a principle that I like to discuss with folks is that, you know, if you take the hard road, it actually results in an easy life and a good life. And if you take the easy road, it results in stress and conflict and dysfunction.
100%.
So I thought that was a really good point for people to hear. This position you're in right now where you have all these things to be grateful for, it wasn't easy. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was really, you had to do the work. You had to go to rehab. And there is I would assume, you know, there was a lot of people that were concerned in your family, like, oh my gosh, Andrew's in rehab. Like,
it's interesting. But first off, you know, you have to truly be at peace with yourself. And I didn't give a crap what people thought. And to this day, if you think it is a mental weakness that I went to rehab, that's your issue. I don't. Really don't give a shit, excuse my French. I just don't care.
Yeah.
And when I got sober, to this day, I only had one person who kind of made fun of me being like, oh, you don't drink anymore, but you can't handle the alcohol. And other than that, everybody was happy. And even my best friends in the world would say, I always worried about you drinking, Andrew. You know, you seem to be doing okay, you know, and, you know, you always, you know, seem to be happy. But man, it always really worried me, and I'm glad you don't drink anymore.
And I'm assuming those people that were your drinking buddies, they just kind of weeded themselves out.
Yeah, and that exactly happened. You know, a drunk will tell you that, oh, everybody drinks. No, the people you hang around with drink. And it's the biggest misconception because, man, I can't emphasize that enough. You have everybody say, I can't quit drinking. You know, everybody drinks in restaurants or everybody drinks watching ball games. And the stone cold reality is your drunk friends do. And I had a couple of people that I kind of just don't really hang out with anymore that our only common ground was that we like to get drunk together. Like we like to drink a lot of beer. And I do have a lot of friends that really drink recreationally, but I can hang out with them if the activity we're doing is something I want to be involved in, you know? Like if I'm out there working on my Bronco and somebody's coming over and they're helping me and they're drinking a lot of beers, but they're still being productive, that doesn't bother me, you know, because our activity is working on the Bronco. When it becomes the activity is drinking, I'm not going to do that, you know. Don't invite me to your crawfish bowl if there's 10 pounds of crawfish and 2 kegs of beer. I ain't coming to your crawfish bowl.
Yeah. Now that's, again, you made that distinction earlier on in the interview, like if you're drinking to intoxication.
Yeah.
You know, like the intoxication is the goal.
That's
it has nothing, it's not tied to anything productive.
That's right.
Other than intoxication, which is, you know, the one of the most unproductive, you know, things you could kind of seek to establish.
And all this is learned. You know, you get sober and it takes you 2 or 3 years to mentally really refocus, you know, to find out who you were. But then first couple of years, all I knew was like I wasn't drinking. And because I told everybody and my brother that everybody, I said, hey, look, I don't drink anymore. I went to rehab. Well, you can go to rehab and be sober and people are cool with it. But if you go to rehab and relapse, I think that's where you're going to run into an issue. And for me, it's ego-based and it's terrible to say that, but I wear that like a badge of honor. Like I got 11 years. You know, you talk all the crap you want. I've been sober for 11 years. And to this day, I have a group of friends of mine that we text each other that are going through sobriety and I wear that like I throw it in their face, man. Like I got 11 years. What do you got? You know, because whatever it takes for you to get along with being sober is what I tell people.
I appreciate you sharing it. I mean, I know it's You know, you've got no other motive here other than to inspire somebody to make some better choices. And I think that's pretty powerful.
It's the best decision I've ever made in my entire life was going sober. And listen, if it hadn't happened, what happened in August 2009, I may not have ever stopped drinking. I would have drank to the day I died. And that's a terrible way to live, to where drinking to intoxication is an actual variable in your life. Like, yeah, that actually matters. I'm so glad. I'm so, so happy I don't do that anymore. It's never worry about a DUI. I don't go to a party and have to worry about how I get home. I don't have to worry about what I posted on Facebook the next morning. There's never a crossword between me and my wife because I've drank and I'm pissed off. It never happens. It's an amazing feeling. I love it. And I strongly encourage you out there, if you feel like you have a problem, you certainly are welcome to reach out to me. Many people have, and I always tell them the same thing. The first thing you got to do is look in the mirror and say, I don't want to do this anymore. Like, I'm an alcoholic. I will never be able to drink like a normal person. It's in my DNA. Like, the way I process alcohol, I'm an alcoholic, period. There's no gray ground. My wife, she can drink a half a glass of wine, and like, that's all that's it. It was never my case. I never drank a half a glass of anything. Ever.
Right.
What's the point? So you have to come to that realization that you like, hey, I don't drink like a normal person. I just never have. And then you can make the steps. If you're not prepared to do that, you're probably going to have a tough time. You really will. And I tell people that. But you can reach out to me. Facebook message. You can call me. Everything's done. I'll never tell anybody your business.
Well, how can people reach you, whether they want to talk about, you know, your sobriety, your journey in that regard, or whether they want to buy, sell, invest, or get into flipping houses? How do you want them to reach out to you?
Well, I have a website, carversells.com, 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 which will actually take you to the J Park Hosting County Andrew Carver website. I'm on Facebook. Easy to find. All my social media, everything is open. Yeah, Andrew Carver, live in Robertsdale, work in Fairhope.
So people send you a private message on Facebook, they can expect an answer?
Absolutely. That happens frequently.
Wow.
People say, hey, look, I see how... People to this day call... You know, I had a conversation with somebody a couple of months ago that said I inspired them, and I'm glad to do that. Anything that helps you enjoy the benefits of life like I have, I'm happy for it, and people have told me that, and I'm happy to do that for anybody. No judgment from me. I was there. You're not going to tell me anything that's going to...
Well, thank you so much for inviting us all, our listeners and myself, into your living room on a Saturday morning to share this. I really appreciate your time. Andrew Carver.
Carver Sells.
CarverSells.com.
Carver, S-E-L-L-S.
CarverSells.com.
That's it.
Thanks, Andrew.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for listening to the Impact Agent Podcast. If you liked the show and got something out of it, please like the Impact Agent Podcast on Facebook and rate and review the show on iTunes or anywhere you listen to podcasts. This really helps us grow the show and helps other agents find it. Please share it with your friends and coworkers as well. You want us to deliver the show to you via email every week? Then email me at jason@impactagentuniversity.com and we'll send you the show every week. Please let us know what you think about the show, what you like, what you don't, or possibly make a suggestion about a topic you want to hear. Email me at jason@impactagentuniversity.com or leave us a message on Facebook at Impact Agent Podcast. Until next week, everybody be productive, safe, and happy, and always keep learning. This podcast is produced by Johnny Gwynn at Deep Fraud Studios in Mobile, Alabama, and is paid for and powered by impactagentuniversity.com.